Here tonight on Game Time, Coach Gi. Now, we just talked about FEU and UST, USC prevailing, but what was it in USC that made them win today?
Well, I think if you look at it in a coach's perspective and also a basketball fan, no, you would really expect a track meet between these two teams. It's also a story of two ends where UST is the number one team in scoring, while FEU is the number two team defensively. But in the game today, I think UST already had 54 points in the first half when they would limit teams into only 65. So in that stat alone, you could really tell that the game was really being dictated by UST, and considering that they also started and they also started strong in their three-point attempts, which is, I think 5 out of 5 to start the game with.
Now, Coach Jermaine Chabio, Soleimani Chabio, was awarded MVP today, and he scored 25 and 10. Now, you, from a coach's perspective, how tough was it, in battling Chabio inside the paint?
Oh, he's a great player. I mean, he's the MVP of the league for a reason. He's a double-double machine. Very humble young man, gives 110% effort every game, and he's the engine that kind of makes them go. I mean, he gives them that level playing field, inside, outside, athleticism, rebounding. So he was tough to guard. He was really tough to guard, but I thought our team did a fairly good job on him, and I think in one of the games he still had a double-double. I think he still had like 17 and 15. So he's a tough competitor.
Pardon me if I'm looking at my phone, because I just got the stats now. 14 three-pointers for UST, Coach Gi. So how vital was it for UST to make their outside shooting to come away with this win?
Well, it's something that the UST fan would wish for, The story of their season is really more of how many three-point shots would they make in their game, and that would dictate the result of whether they're going to win or lose in that game. Just looking back into our season, we were able to limit them. That's why somehow we were able to manage to pull away some wins against them. But most of their games, talagang it's really hard to beat a team like UST when you have 4 out of 5 players making all those shots.
Now, in your season record, Coach Jermaine, you beat USC twice, but then got beaten by FEU also twice. Yeah. What is the difference, in style of play between these two teams?
Well, the difference is kind of like what Coach Gian said. I think with our team, we had a lot of length, so we could go out there and challenge USC's three-point shots, kind of run them off the line, and kind of rebound. Where with FEU, they had an import, a 7-foot guy, who we would also try to run FAU out off the line, but they had a bigger guy who would clean up the boards. They had a speedy, quick point guard who got better as the season went, and they just kind of outplayed us, to be honest.
Amongst your conversation, I know you guys were together in the car coming here, and I'm sure you talked about on who was going to win today. Yeah. So for you, Coach Jermaine, who was it?
I thought FAU was going to win just because I thought they kind of had the momentum. They kind of start playing very well at the right time. But just like Coach Gian said, I mean, if you give UST the three-point ball, I mean, they're going to make you pay.
For you, Coach Gi.
Yeah, same with Coach. We were really thinking FEU. They're in a 5-game winning streak, I think, heading into this step-ladder match. Their guys off the bench were also stepping up. Stockton was really playing well for them in their last 3-4 games. I think it was very unfortunate for them, for LJ Gonzalez in particular, to suffer cramps in the last 3 minutes of the game, which I think kind of dictated how the game would go.
If Barkley Ibonia was still on the floor, he got ejected in the second quarter. Do you think that could have made a difference?
He was the only player, actually, got this thing going in the first half for them. They were giving him the ball. I think USD defended the guards really well. Kaya may mga drop passes kay Ibonia. Unfortunate lang na he was ejected.
Now, Coach Jermaine, if you were to talk amongst the coaches and the players, if there's this one or two guys from USC that you will really defend in crunch time, who would it be?
I mean, it has to be the MVP. I mean, Chabio, he's won MVP for a reason. The other guy would be the veteran,
Subido?
Him. No, not him. Oh. The guy who went to
Pariso.
Yeah, I mean, he's, I think he's played on the championship team before, I believe, at De La Salle. So he has that experience, and he showed up big today. I think he had 18 big points. He's the calming factor. You know, he's the calming factor for them. He makes tough shots. He takes tough shots, and he plays defense. He knows his role.
Yeah. Now, the third pick, your portion, Coach Gi. Chabio had 25, Paraiso had 18, Brent Subido had 14, but Trent Sabando only with 9 points. Yeah. Is that a case of picking your poison, or did they really expect for others just to, like Paraiso, just to kill you?
Yeah, well, UST, again, not, if you're just going to base it on the numbers, UST is number one in bench points. So guys like Brent, Paraiso, guys like Zach Wang, they would really have games that, you know, would really help UST with their cause. And for I think for Abando to just score 9 points, it's nothing new to them. I'm sure in every other way he would still affect the game, change other shots, defend the guards, and yun yung naging signature na ni Coach Aldin, he makes all of his players two-way.
Mm. All right, so now it will be UP, Coach Jermaine. So what do you think, how do you think this will go now?
I think it'll be a tough matchup. I mean, I think, again, if UST is knocking down the three-point shot, it's going to be a long day. I think with UP's athleticism, they could probably run them off the line. But again, it's going to be a battle.
All right, so let's transition now, Coach Gi. Both of you, your first year with the De La Salle Green Archers, it's been a roller coaster ride. But can you just tell us from your perspective, personally, how would you assess the team, coaching staff, in your first season?
Well, if you're coming from a school that has a winning tradition, anything less than a championship, anything less than make it to the Final Four will be a disappointment. I would say it wasn't really that bad if you're going to look at it at both ends. We were 7-7. We had really good games that we were really proud of our guys. And you know, it's just a matter of circumstances, things that, you know, kind of beyond our control. Some players got sick, some players got injured. But, you know, at the end of the day, if there's something that I could take into heading to the next season is how we were able to play through adversity. And, you know, it's something, again, me and Coach would talk about, and we're really proud of our players.
Now, Coach Jermaine, being the active consultant, I'm sure that there are some styles and there are some systems that you would want to for the players to emulate, but how was that from a coaching perspective? Did you have any adjustment in terms of transitioning to the Philippine game?
For me, the only adjustment was just the physicality. I mean, like I said several times, when I first got here, you know, I was trying to teach guys how to play without fouling, trying to just teach them to contest, and they kind of looked at me crazy. You know, they would be, you know, some of our veteran players, they would look at me and be like, and then as we played our first UF game, I had to scrap how I was teaching them for 3 or 4 months because it is a different game on the physicality side. But at the end of the day, it's basketball. I think as the season went on, I got better. I thought our players got better. Kind of like what Coach Gian said, you know, the one thing I was disappointed in is just our inconsistency. You know, we would have some games where we looked really good, and then we would have some other games where we looked like, you know, we were not good. So it was a learning curve for all players and myself, and looking forward to working hard and coming back stronger for season 83.
Coach Gi, when the team was down at 1-3, personally, or can you give us a hint on what was going on? Did you hit the panic button, or what was it like?
Not really. I mean, with the way, if you would see how our players would approach practice, even we were at 1-3, you could tell the trust was there. You could tell that, you know, they were still in it. Sometimes we would see them, for us coaches as a new coaching staff, you would think ngana, you would press that panic button right away. But, you know, seeing those players, seeing the veterans lead the young guys, kind of settled us down also. And again, we are really proud of how our guys handled these adversities.
Your assessment, Coach, of your core, Baltazar, Melesho, Karakut, some of the guys you've worked with in the juniors program, how have you seen them grow this year?
Well, they're good as advertised. you know, Migs. Justin, of course, I think he back-to-back Mythical Five member. He has improved his range for Andre. Transitioning into a point guard is one of his concerns. One of our concerns also heading into the season, which we really think he did a good job. I think 4.5 assists per game is not bad for a point a player who's transitioning into a point guard. For Aljun, again, it's just a matter of being consistent. And you know, Aljun being Aljun, he would really take those big shots, and he won't hesitate to do that. And you know, it's something that we have to ride on at times as well.
Coach Jermaine, you mentioned the word inconsistency, and there were a couple of games that the team fell short. Yeah. But if you would note one or two games, what would those games be?
For me, first, the first UP game. I mean, I thought that was by far our best game we played. We just didn't put together a full 40 minutes. I thought we led the game for like 39 minutes and something seconds. And then the UE game. I mean, you know, our best defender, Jamie, he didn't play that game. And Swartze, he had a hell of a game. Those two games are must wins for us, and that's the reason we didn't.
Why do you think so? What happened down the stretch?
Down the stretch, I mean, for the UP game, we just didn't get it done. It's no excuse. We were winning the whole game. We had a couple turnovers, had a couple missed free throws, and we just didn't get it done. And one of their players hit a big time shot. And then for the UE game, another opportunity we let slip away. I mean, it really was nothing they did. It was all on us. It was all on our team. It was all on me. So those two games.
What about in the second round, Coach? Is there any moment in particular, any game in particular that, you know, if we won this in the second round, we might have made it?
That would be that FEU game. Unfortunately, we lost big in that game. But heading into that game, the coaching staff, we really thought we had a good game plan heading into that game. But, you know, things happen. And somehow, again, just going to play, seeing our players go through adversities, we were able to bounce back afterwards and played USD, won against USD. But again, just to answer your question, it's something I want to look back at during the second round. It's just that FEU game.
Now, for season 82, coaches, perhaps a record-setting number of players that are quote-unquote one and done,
yeah,
meaning they play for 1 year, then they're gone. I want to get your thoughts on this, since LaSalle has three one and done players. Coach Jermaine.
I think it's a good experiment. I mean, for me, the game is just a lot different. In our instance, we had three of them. So it's already enough if you have one. Just trying to get them used to the physicality, used to the weather, used to the environment. But I think our three guys did a heck of a job. They bought in. We never had any problems from them. But it's a different game. And then you look at a guy like Val, who went to Adamson. He had an opportunity to be out here for a couple months, play in the D-League, play against some teams. So I think coming in, that's why his adjustment was so seamless. And for the guy from UE, Suerte, he's from Davao, so he's from the Philippines. So it was a little bit easier for those guys. I think our staff and our managers did a great job trying to prepare myself and trying to prepare our three one and done guys, and that's, to me, that's the big difference.
Yeah. Coach Gi, whether Filipino or American, the fact that there are players that are one and done, like Suerte, Val, Chauca, your players, but then do you see much of pros and cons? What does it do for the game?
For the game, it gives a different look to, especially for the local players. No? It raises the level of game, I would say. But more than anything, I think it's just a matter of when these guys will come in.
What do you mean when? Playing year or literally the time that they have with the team?
Yes.
Okay.
The time that they will come and, you know, be there and to prepare with the team.
Okay.
I think that really that would really help the cause of all the other teams who are planning to get the one and done player. The earlier you get them, the better it would be for the team.
Coach Key, but what about the spirit of amateurism? When you develop players, maybe at least from first year, second year, from high school, I want to get your thoughts on that.
Well, it would be the call naman of the school if they really wanna if they really wanna do it. Of course, I would always tell Coach Germain and even the management that the next 2 years, the high school division is really loaded with talent, and you know, you really can't turn a blind eye on these guys. Talagang they're talented as talented. We're talking about the likes of Carl Tamayo, Jerry Abadiano, Terence Fortea, RC Kalimag of LaSalle Green Hills, Mac Guadagna of Lyceum. So you know, in terms of getting them into your program, I don't think it would really hurt.
And the recruitment in that level will still be alive.
And yes. Well.
So just lastly, my last question for you, Coach Germain. Core is intact for next year. Yeah. Only four players will graduate. How do you think LaSalle can improve next year?
Oh, I think the future is bright. We also have an import who's been with us the whole year. He's ready to rock. Our core is back. Expecting big things from Alvin. Expecting even bigger things from Baltazar and even Serrano. Sure. So I'm excited to be a part of this and ready for next year.
All right, so there you have it. De La Salle Green Archers head coach Gia Nazario and active consultant Jermaine Bird. Gentlemen, maraming salamat. Thank you for joining us here on ANC Game Time.